Now, how this book came about, I have been to every single San Diego Comic Con, including the first one in 1970, and I was also somebody who was into photography starting in the late 70s, and I actually had a dark room and did all kinds of, you know, professional photography for various people. And so I would go to Comic Con and I would just take a million pictures. And over the years, I, you know, had friends that I gave away and did things to, and just had all over the house and in the garage and in closets, you know, one use pictures here and some pictures there. And last fall, somebody just mentioned to me, there's this new company in San Diego and they want to create a site online that's just archives convention photos of various kinds. Do you have any? I said, oh, do I have them? I said, but, you know, it would take a lot of work for me to try to get them all out. He said, well, if you just give us the negatives, we'll digitize everything for you. Well, they digitized about 3,000 negatives, very high quality files, and so I felt, okay, now I have to do a book. So I went through and picked out, I decided the theme would be focused on the people for this. So there's lots of pictures of dealers' rooms and masquerades and other kinds of things that you see at shows, but I tried to focus this on the people who, in those days, in the 70s and 80s at Comic-Con, you could go and just hang out with Sigourney Weaver, the creator of Superman, Jack Kirby, Will Eisner, Carl Barks.
All at the same time.
All at the same time, hanging around in a room.
And they were talking to each
other. And then
all in the same hotel room.
Yeah.
And we were a lot freer about our bodies back then.
And Scott Shaw, who's here today, was one of the people who founded Comic-Con.
Don't use that word, please.
What's Scott Shaw?
Founder, it kind of gives me the sweat.
Anyway, so he's in the book. So people who buy the book can get him designed as a
special edition right
now. Don is in the book, so he can turn things. But just as a teaser, this was a Kickstarter project. So people at some higher levels, one of the things they get is a calendar of photos from the book. So this is a handy way to see big versions of some of the photos. So this is Harvey Kurtzman and Jack Kirby together. Two in my pantheon, the two of the top four.
That was that ventriloquist.
Is there a fold-out of Captain Sticky's head?
That would be really quite a fold-out. And it's not just people from comics, but people from animation, comic strips. And you've got Charles Schulz, and you've got Bob Clampett, his daughter's here. We have people from science fiction and fantasy, like Ray Bradbury. So it was all kinds of people mixing together. And one of the great things about Comic-Con those days is that a lot of those conversations between people from different mediums and genres ended up in projects that people did together and lifelong friendships. So it was a unique period in the history of comics.
You've got a lot of photos of like counterculture people in there.
Well,
too,
and for instance, here's Dan Clowes and Jaime Hernandez hanging out with Bob Burton. That one's from 1984, and you know, this was before 8-Ball even came out. Again, so it was there, and this is early years of Love and Rockets.
That was their first album cover.
And here's a picture it's Al Williamson, one of the greats of EC Comics, and you know, more recently was inker for John Newton Jr., but you know, with Mike Royer, who was Jack Kirby's inker, and then with the
was Carradine?
Carradine.
David Carradine.
I always want to get my Carradines mixed up. But David Carradine and Patrick Culleton, who was an escape artist. So these guys were hanging around together in 1984. There's Ray Bradbury in 1974. Bradbury loved Comic-Con. He came practically every year, down to right before he died. He was in his wheelchair, just having a ball. He loved comics, especially things like Buck Rogers, but he would always do a very inspirational talk that was the one thing, if he didn't do anything else, he had to go to Ray Bradbury's. There's Claremont and Frank Miller.
Oh, wow.
Apparently, it was at this time they talked about doing a Wolverine mini series where he was going to go to Japan. So, that was the genesis of.
Whatever happened to that?
Probably on the wall.
Frank looks wholesome and Chris looks.
Yeah.
In 1980, National Lampoon was at its height, and they set a whole contingency of cartoonists to San Diego. So this is Jerry Flanagan, and the guys writing on there, Stan Rodriguez from Underground Comics, and B.K. Taylor, and S. Gross, who, his most famous cartoon was the frog with the legs dropped off on a little cart.
Jackie, what kind of dates are in this? Are cartoonist birthdays?
The only things that I added besides the regular dates were the dates of the first San Diego Con and Free Comic Book Day and the release date for this book. So there's Carl Barks, number three in my top four of all time greats, and he was there with Garrett. You could just see Bart's paintings. They would just be there at the show. They would be in the art show, they'd be at whoever's table he'd be at that year. And
in fact, that show was like Carl was had the rights taken away from him for quite a while from Disney because somebody was selling a very early version of where you could essentially do Xerox copying onto canvas. And they were selling a bogus Carl Bart's pictures. And I said, does Carl know about me? He said, oh yeah, he does. He's been home by now.
Yeah.
And by this, I wrote him a letter, and our letters crossed in the mail, and we got back one that said, well, they finally took it away from me, but he said, if I worked at General Motors, they wouldn't let me get my own Chevrolet.
He had such a great attitude about things. In 1979, the Comic-Con's treasurer took everything home from the convention and then went out to dinner with the family and came back and somebody had broken the house and stolen all the receipts, all the money that had been made at Comic-Con that year, except for the checks and stuff which they put in the oven. So they never know who did it, but anyway, Comic-Con had no money. So we did a fundraiser, which was to solicit artwork from people and sell it via auction. We had a big two-page spread in the Comics buyer's guide. And David Strobe and I went to Carl Barks' house because he lived at that time in Temecula. And, they made lunch for us, and he showed me his Pride baseballs, and then he gave us a painting to auction on this part. And that was the biggest selling item. It was not a giant one, it was like, a 9x12 or so, but still, just, that was a unique pleasure to be able to just go and visit him in his house. Now, this is Osamu Tezuka, who of course created Astro Boy, and Kim Kawamu, and all the fabulous manga he did of every possible kind. And there was a contingency of Japanese manga, anime, and fans that came in 1980. Somebody organized, like a travel agency actually organized the trip, and Tezuka was the main guy, but Monkey Punch and Bonagai and a couple other artists were there, and they hosted a party that was by invitation only. If you came, they gave you all kinds of goodies, and it was just very, they gave us hospitality. But you could just go in the deal with him, and he was just sitting and drawing. He's doing Simba. Mm-hmm. And drawing here, he's got Astro Boy there. And so that was a one-of-a-kind experience. And here's Alan Moore. Apparently, I'm the only person who ever took a picture of Alan Moore when he was at Comic-Con when he was there, because that's the picture you see everywhere, sometimes with Jack Kirby in it and sometimes without.
Here he's just capture Jack Kirby's inner essence. Now auctioning it off.
So this is the Kirby Awards, and Moorhead obviously kept the sign things for small thing at that time because, you know, they hadn't done much anymore. And so boy.
Looks like he's doing Swamp Thing.
And this is Al Williamson again with one of my dear friends, Dave Stevens. They have for years talked on the phone, exchanged letters, but they have never ever met in person, so.
Very moving.
What did Al say when he met?
My son.
Oh, you knew the answer to that one.
Well, I thought everyone should know.
This is, you know, part of the kind of underground alt contingency that you saw in the late 70s, early 80s at Comic Con. This is the Klee Band, F. Klee Band, the Klee Band cat that everybody was, that was so sad for so long, with a black and white striped cat. And which, to his chagrin, he made tons of money on it, but he had been a Playboy cartoonist, so it's like, I don't like to be kindly Mr. Cat when I'm doing my Playboy cartoons. Melinda Gebbe, underground cartoonist who is now married to Alan Moore. Victor Moscoso, one of the original Zap artists who also did album covers and posters, film work type posters. Dan O'Neill, who did Oz Boston's and did the famous Air Pirates comics that got him in trouble with Disney in a lawsuit. But I will tell you a story about Klee Band, and it's like in the book, all of the captions are really my stories about him. We used to have these breakfasts at Comic Con, and you could ask to sit at anybody's guest table and you could sign up for it. So I was at his table at breakfast, and there were a bunch of fans there, and this one woman said, "Would you talk to a cat for my sister, please?" She said, "Oh, sister. But make it a Chinese cat." Chinese, I don't draw some. I draw stripey guys. That's all I draw. Oh, please, don't please. So he goes, "Okay." He tried to hand it to her. Two stripey guys tied together at the end. He was just one of the cleverest persons I've ever met. One of those people that, you know, if you're around cartoonists a lot, they get asked a lot of the same questions and you hear the same answer. He always had a different answer every time somebody asked the same question. Okay, here's Bob Clampett hanging out with Adam West, who was Batman, Kirk Allen, who was Superman in serials, and two science fiction authors, Larry Niven and George Purnell. So I love those combinations that was happening, just hanging out at parties. That one was 1980 as well. Now, speaking of your favorite, Captain Sticky.
Captain Sticky.
Here's Captain Sticky.
Is it Johnny Jim?
This is Alex Toth. Yeah. It's not Toth, it's Toth. And there's Durenko. Again, partying at Comic Con. That was 1979 at the Inkpot Awards.
That may be the only photo of Captain Sticky where he's not surrounded by Russ Meyer purporting.
Yeah. I didn't put any of those in the book. I didn't want to, you know, bring down the level of class.
Bring up the circulation.
And this is when Julia Schwartz received an Inkpot Award, Ray Bradbury presented it. So during a course of the presentation, Sergio would do drawings, and, you know, how quick it is. Sergio is, he'd be doing these quick drawings, so he did a drawing of Julia, you know, becoming Superman. Well, Harlan Ellison comes running up on stage, and he says, "Julie, since you're giving this award and everything, I want to take this opportunity to give you that Batman script." Was it Batman?
Batman
script that I've been promising you for years and years and years, and made a big thing about it. And, you know, turns out it was for blank paper, and he really hadn't.
We published it.
The blank paper.
Yeah. It's published in the third volume of Strength of History.
To wrap up, it'd be December 2015 calendar. I always love to use this photo of Captain Ross Kirby. There was a band called Seduction of the Innocent that was put together just for Comic-Con. It consisted of Bill Mooney and Max Allen Collins, Miguel Ferrer, and Steve Laiolo. And they wrote a song called King Jack that they would play, and that's what they're dancing to out in the dance. So those are some samplings of photos that are in the book. Back here we have Dick Schuster and Dick Siegel. Got Stanley with Jim Shooter, with Andy Heaney, with Clarence Nash, the voice of Donald Duck. He called me a few times as Donald Duck. 7 o'clock in the morning, oh, so it's always fun to be the representative for Comic-Con in those days, because I was the only one that people knew was at home, because I was a freelancer. So if somebody wanted to call Comic-Con with questions, everybody else was like full-time people who couldn't be reached till 8 o'clock at night, so I'd get the phone calls. Anyway, does anybody have any questions about the books?
The original project you mentioned about the website that was going to be, that we're looking for.
It's called Webble.
W-E-B-B-L-E.
B-B-L-E, okay. And it's a very ambitious project because one of the things they're doing is kind of a virtual convention. If everybody's at a convention and they all they can all be uploading audio, video stuff to the site for that convention,
right,
the Webble. And they can also, it also has a GPS type thing where they will triangulate in the hall so you can find a booth, you can find a kid that you lost. It's a very ambitious type thing. So it's webble.com.
Yeah, because Amanda, we were talking about the cosplay. Sorry.
Oh, what?
No, but you were saying like you didn't put a lot of the costume stuff, but in there on their archives for older conventions,
yeah,
there'll be a lot of costumes.
Yeah, if you go there now, they've got all kinds of photos and stuff from a lot of different shows with, you know, cosplay. And, you know, got a lot from the 2014.
Of course, yeah.
Was there a part where the photos were originally black and white, then you switched to color, or were all color originally?
They were all black and white with just some color. So there was, I'm certain that there's some negatives I have not found yet, because it seemed like a couple of years were really skimpy. But there were a couple of years that I had a lot of color, and so I made a point. There is this black and white book. And I had a dark room, so I developed all my own stuff, so I was going to do black and white, I wasn't going to do color. But I do have a color section, and so I tried to put photos in that color was what made it, you know,
Bob Kane
drawing Batman and Robin, and, you know, Jack, Harvey Kurtzman with a whole bunch of underground cartoonists, and they all have Hawaiian shirts on, and Katie King's boss man, Bill Wagon, with his Katie King tie, things of that nature. So yeah, there's 16 pages of color in here. And not 100% of the photos are from San Diego Con, because I also went to some science fiction and fantasy type shows in the 70s. So there's some stuff from WorldCon. There's a lot of science fiction links that are in here that never came to San Diego Con, but I, you know, managed to get closer than at other shows. But, you know, people who did come, Robert Heinlein, Gary Sturgeon, you know, all the real biggies of science fiction. So, anybody else have a question? I think we're going to have some...
One more question. Any people that you wish could have photographed that you weren't able to photograph, or weren't able to make the conventions or something?
Well, no, it's weird that there's some people that I know were there every year, but somehow I don't have a photo from that period. Like Bud Plant was one of the judges every year, but I have pictures of his booth, but not him. Mm-hmm. And then Paul Levitz, I just have a picture in here that's the back of his head. That was the only one I had that was my one hedge in the whole thing is that I put a picture of Mike Richardson in that was from 1991 because I wanted him to be in the book, because everybody else was in the book. And it's like, Mike's got to be in there. The next, you know, this does well, then the next one's 90s because I have one.
Thank you.
Thanks for taking pictures.
Yeah.
Who knew at the time?
When Harvard did it, I mean, it wasn't the easiest thing in the world. Now everyone's going around, you know, we're all taking.
I had my bounce flash and, you know, all my equipment and everything.
And there were many less opportunities to do so. I mean, now there's a convention in.
Oh, right.
Or any major city, and that one every weekend or two.
Except for everybody that's big has a line, so you're trying to get to the front of the line to get a shot. No pictures, unless you're paying $20.
We forget.